Hi, everybody. Welcome to Philly Jazz Talks. I'm Suzanne Cloud, Project Director of the Philadelphia Jazz Legacy Project. And this evening, we're going to be talking about Lee Morgan. We're going to be talking with biographer and scholar Tom Perchard and trumpeter educator Duane Eubanks. Archivist Jack McCarthy will be interviewing these men about the impact of Lee Morgan's life and music and on Philadelphia, the city, and the musicians he's touched through his recordings. But before we do that, I got to take care of some business. So it's important that you know that these monthly Jazz Talks are brought to you by the Philadelphia Jazz Legacy Project. And we are an organization whose mission is to establish a permanent jazz archive of the Philadelphia area and all the jazz artists who live and work here through recordings, video interviews, manuscripts, material culture like photographs, programs, posters, anything that relates to Philadelphia jazz and its history. I'd also like to thank the Philadelphia Cultural Fund for sponsoring these monthly talks. Without their help, these programs would not be possible. And I'd also like to thank the people who have supported us with their donations. We appreciate it so much. I'd like to acknowledge a donation from last month from saxophonist Dave Wilson. Thanks, Dave. Appreciate it. Next month, Philly Jazz Talks will be taking a break because I'm going to Maine for a little vacay. And we will resume in September with a discussion with Philadelphia trumpeter Randy Brecker about his life and his upcoming gig in October with the South Jersey Jazz Society. As most of you should know, Randy Brecker was part of the famous Brecker Brothers and is still going strong. To get a reminder of the events that we're doing, you can get on our monthly newsletter as a subscriber. It only comes out once a month. So go to our website at PhillyJazzHistory.org and sign up for the newsletter. And you can find out what we're doing, see original life history interviews that we're doing with noted jazz musicians. So sign up if you want to know when Randy's going to be here. That's going to be a great jazz talk. Now, to introduce tonight's guests. Writer Professor Tom Perchard teaches in the Department of Music at Goldsmiths at the University of London. In fact, he's been kind enough to get up in the middle of the night to participate in this talk. Philly, thanks you, Tom. Tom's work centers on the history of jazz and popular music. He's the author of After Django, Making Jazz in Postwar France, and that's out of the University of Michigan Press. And of course, the book about the man we're going to be discussing tonight, Lee Morgan, His Life, Music and Culture. And that's at the Equinox Press. Perchard is currently working on a book on popular music in post-war British, post-war World War II British home. Our second celebrity tonight is trumpeter Duane Eubanks, and he comes from an illustrious jazz family in Philadelphia. That includes his brothers, trombonist Robin, and guitarist Kevin Eubanks, his late uncle, pianist Ray Bryant, and Vera Eubanks, his mother, who taught pianist Kenny Barron as a boy. We've got the picture to prove it too. Duane studied jazz in master classes at Temple University with Dr. Billy Taylor, and was mentored and nurtured for 2 years by trumpeter Johnny Coles, a major influence. Duane then headed to New York, where he joined pianist Mulgrew Miller's ensemble Wingspan. Double bassist bandleader Dave Holland invited Duane to play with his big band on a pair of Grammy Award-winning albums. Duane has been a hotly sought-after trumpeter, recording with Elvin Jones, John Hicks, Curtis Fuller, Lewis Hayes, Randy Brecker, Avery Sharp, Nicholas Payton. He's also worked with Antonio Hart, Illinois Jacquet, Oliver Lake, Phyllis Hyman, Donald Byrd, and James Moody, to name a few. He's got a number of projects out. I just bought the latest, which is Duane Eubanks Quintet, live at Smalls, which you can find on his website at duaneeubanks.com. The late trumpeter, Wallace Roney, who we lost during the COVID year and a half, once said of Duane, "I love Duane's playing. He means those notes. You hear that bad Philly legacy proudly all up in there." Close quote. Lastly, archivist Jack McCarthy will be with us tonight to lead the conversation between these two Lee Morgan fans, with me butting in once in a while. Jack works with me on the Philadelphia Jazz Legacy Project, and he's well known as a historian of Philly R&B and jazz, and as the lead archivist working with the Philadelphia Orchestra. So welcome to everyone who's here tonight, and let's go.
Okay, thanks, Suzanne. My introduction is much shorter, as it should be, than these two esteemed gentlemen that I'm going to be talking with today. They have, you know, some really pretty amazing accomplishments. We're going to start with Tom and his book, and welcome. I thought Tom was the furthest geographic participant tonight. He's in England, in London, but I just saw there's somebody from Perth, Australia on the call today. So I can't imagine what time they're tuning in that part of the world. But Tom, your book is not a typical biography of a musician, you know, with all the personal life and the discographical material. It's more of a study of the musical milieu and culture that created somebody like Lee Morgan. So you want to talk about your approach and how you went about, you know, studying his life and culture?
Yeah, I think that I'm not sure it started out like that, but pretty soon I think the idea developed to do something which was a little bit different from the normal kind of very, very individual focused, very often heroic kind of biography, where the focus is very, very closely on the subject. This is not just something you find in music biographies, but this is biography in general, right? Obviously, I'm deeply interested in Lee Morgan, the individual and the heroic individual, but really, one of the main question that very quickly emerged for me was to do with the soil from which Lee Morgan sprang, because he was an exceptional individual, but he was one among many. And quickly, I think the overriding concern for me came to be to study the environments that Lee Morgan was emerging from and working in. Primarily, that's Philadelphia. So I really wanted to know what kinds of social and musical, but and socio-musical structures were in place or developed by people like Lee to produce that kind of music at that time, and all of those other great people who were coming up at the same time, because it's a remarkable thing, right? I mean, the Philadelphia jazz of the 40s, 50s, 60s and on, it's an unusual thing. I wasn't really aware of too many studies at that time. There weren't too many studies at that time that really tried to understand the music as a product of its kind of social and political context at the time. So I was really interested by those things, but I wanted to always see it through the lens of Lee Morgan and actually hear it through the lens of Lee Morgan as well. I didn't just want to do a kind of, you know, sociological study of, you know, the setup in North Philadelphia, industrialization, employment, the formal and informal music education networks that were in place, and just say, there we are, you know, and map it all out. I wanted to almost kind of experience it as Lee Morgan experienced it as he went along.
So that's interesting to us here in Philadelphia, who, you know, are so proud of our jazz musical heritage that produced so many jazz giants. For you, it was a process of realization that, oh my God, he came out of this unbelievably rich culture and I really need to study that. Is that sort of how it evolved?
You realize it pretty quickly. I mean, jazz is such a collaborative social music. Every time you hear a good jazz performance, you're hearing that society in action. And as soon as you start to, you know, when I was a young teenager learning, getting into jazz, as soon as you start researching these names, you know, who is this person? Who are these guys? And then you start to realize that they grew up in the same place. Quite a lot of the people on Lee Morgan's records are people from Philadelphia he grew up with, and same for the guys from Detroit and Chicago, often bringing in people they've been very tight with for a long time. You start to realize that there are kind of social networks in play when we hear them in professional contexts. So I really wanted to go back a bit further and see how those networks were formed. Well, those guys were forming those networks when they were kids. Definitely the case with Lee Morgan and his North Philly confreres, and then the South Philly confreres as well. Mm-hmm. I think it was always apparent to me that it was being in Philadelphia, doing research in Philadelphia, and understanding the kinds of the ways that this theater is around the corner from this theater, which is around the corner from this bar where, you know, this happened, and this around the corner from this musician's mother who hosted all of these traveling musicians as they came through. And you start to understand the kind of the network on the ground, you know, that produces all of those kinds of things.
And yeah, so you're sort of 20 some white guy coming from England. How did you access this culture? I know you had a number of like pretty important people that sort of gave you entree to this world, and many of whom were, you know, really close to Lee Morgan at one point. You want to talk about them and how you use them as points of reference and sources?
You know, to the extent that I did manage to access it, I would say that it was just by, you know, hitting the phone book and hitting the phone largely. And the key for me was when, right at the beginning of the project, I was going to the newspapers, looking at the newspaper reports of Lee Morgan's funeral, and just writing down the names of everyone who's participating, and then just going through the phone book and phoning people up and seeing if I could talk to them. And one of the first guys that I got in touch with was James Spady, who was a journalist, cultural historian, and many, many other things as well, who turned out to be a really important mentor in terms of not just the project. And he gave me some help on the project and gave me a couple of phone numbers and things like that. But more importantly than that, I was able to almost nightly, actually, for a period of about 6 months, just meet up and just talk about Philadelphia. And I really got to understand the a mid-century Philadelphian experience with Spady, and lots of other scholars across the world have had that same experience. Apart from that, it was, you know, doing any kind of research is snowballing. Like me, if you're walking as a complete outsider, you know, walking into a contest like this, it's about finding one person and asking them for recommendations, and then finding more and more and more. So when I spoke to Don Wilson, for instance, we had a fantastic, had a 5-hour interview where he gave me so much, such a rich account of what it was like to be a developing musician in Tioga, and touched on all of those things that I was talking about there, learning. How did Lee Morgan come to learn to improvise? You know, and he talked about how he would go through writing down little kind of fake solos, if you like, that he would perform as if improvised, and then just taking that little bit out and maybe adding a little bit of genuine improvisation here and gradually crossfading into actual soloing, you know, that kind of thing. And that, having that first-hand account of Don Wilson, a slightly older musician who was observing Lee at that point, was great. And then we got to Wallace Thomas and various other friends and associates from that time who really gave a really behind a great thick behind the scenes account of what the jazz life was like. And obviously that's had many downsides as well as upsides, but the snowballing effect. Philly also being the kind of place that it is, a pretty small place, meant that people would see you on the street and say, "Oh, aren't you that guy who's writing that book about Lee Morgan? Who are you?" you know what Philadelphia's like, and that often led to lots of great stuff.
Yeah, Philadelphia, we always claim, is a city of neighborhoods, And there are definitely these sections, little enclaves. The two biggest one for mid-century jazz, as you well know, as you talk about in your book, is sort of the North Philly coterie and then the South Philly. You want to talk a little bit about that and how they connected to each other and the different sources that you used from each?
Well, this is one of the things that I was really interested in because, you know, Philadelphia is it a mid-sized town, would you call it? And still it had these little pockets of musical communities, which had their own really quite distinct identities, actually. And that kind of surprised me. It surprised me when I was talking to someone like Sam Reed or someone, right, that South Philadelphia thought of itself as, you know, a different clique to the North Philadelphians. There was contact between them. You know, people would phone up and say, oh, we've got this session. South Philly's going to be there. Are you going to be there? You know, I love that kind of stuff. I love that idea that there's this kind of discrete kind of divisions in this Philadelphia jazz army. It would be mobilized at any point. But I mean, those different sections had their different kinds of, I keep calling them support structures. I know that sounds a bit dry, but you know what I mean. I mean, so in North Philadelphia, we had the Richard Allen Projects with the Rec Room, which is a really, really important place for lots of young musicians who lived there and thereabouts, including Lee Morgan. South Philadelphia had the Heath Brothers, Mrs. Heath, who was a stalwart and someone who really helped a lot of musicians, and the Timmons and those kinds of people. So yeah, I was, and then West Philadelphia as well, I was interested in the ways that these kinds of, these musical groups cohered around what were actually small, but somewhat isolated at that time, African-American communities, different sections of, thereof, you know. I think it's important to recognize that North Philadelphia in the early 1950s was nothing like North Philadelphia as it is now. It's much of a really, really mixed neighborhood, Ukrainians, Italians, Germans, and then increasingly African-Americans. But Lee Morgan's family was one of the first African-American families on the block, in fact. And then, you know, this is one of the many social processes that happens at that time, which I find really fascinating, because then white flight starts and then segregation, de facto segregation sets in that we might see today. So yeah, that's a good example actually of the ways that those sorts of social setups reflected on the musical.
Right.
Can I butt in here a little bit, Jack? Because we're getting already the time. I'm watching the time. I'd like to get some of the pictures, Tom, if you could.
Let Tom sort of narrate some of those photos. Lex, you want to bring them up?
Yeah, well, we haven't got much time, so let's just run through them very quickly. I mean, there we are. This is from the Massbaum yearbook. The technical college that Lee went to, which had a music class, which is a kind of adjunct to an instrument repair class, and had grown into a really, really important place of nurturing for young Philadelphia jazz musicians, and have been for some time. Actually, there's I made a list of this because I remember Joe Wilder, Red Rodney, Buddy DeFranco, Bill Barron, Tommy Bryant, Johnny Coles, Ted Curson, Henry Grimes, Lee. I mean, you know, Sam an Reed. Embarrassment of riches.
Sam Reed too.
Yeah, Sam Reed.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, there you are, amazing.
Yeah. This is such a rich story. Tom, you want to talk about the importance of Music City?
Yeah, it's the instrument dealership that also had sessions, one of several places that had these kinds of jam sessions, actually. Here's Lee looking pretty well dressed, I think, for a young guy.
He's all of 15 there.
Yeah, that's incredible. There you are. I actually asked a trumpet instrument maker what that brand was quite recently. The brand of trumpet it was making. The reply I got was so impossibly detailed, I can't begin to get into it. There we are. It's Lee and Jimmy Garrison, who lived right opposite the Richard Allen Projects. I don't know where this photo was taken, but it's somewhere thereabouts, I think.
So that's part
of
it.
He had a jam session. I think, didn't Sam Reed? No. It was
just Keys, yeah.
Tootie Heath told me that Lee Morgan, McCoy Tyner, and everybody, and him used to go over to McCoy Tyner's house to play. Was that it?
McCoy Tyner's mum had a beauty shop, which had a piano in it. So they would often have jam sessions whilst people were getting their hair done.
I know. Well, Tootie told me that because they were from South Philly, they were afraid to go, but Lee Morgan kind of smoothed the way going up into that neighborhood. I mean, getting back to the competition between the neighborhoods, it was cute.
Yeah. There's lots of interesting stuff, actually. Well, I can carry on talking about this, and we know where this is. And this is Lex Humphreys. And there's lots of stuff in the book, actually. This is the kind of thing that I was really surprised to find out about. About that, the kind of lack of mobility that people had around Philadelphia, as well as the mobility, the difficulty that people had going from neighborhood to neighborhood, that could be because you were African American and the neighborhood you were going to was emphatically not, so you might have some trouble getting in, but it didn't have to be that. There's lots of stuff in the book about gangs and the way that certain corners were policed by certain kinds of and elements, but the ways that musicians were allowed to get around that, musicians, artists, sportsmen, had a kind of free pass a lot of the time.
Sam Reed told me that he had a car in South Philly, but Lee Morgan didn't. So Sam would drive up to Lee's house and they would rehearse together.
Right.
Because Sam was like 2.5 years older, so he had a car before Lee would have. Yeah.
So what's the next photo? Yeah, this is interesting. This is from one of the VJ sessions called in Chicago, with Bobby Timmons, and there's something about this photo which I really enjoy, which is the very, very unguarded nature of it. You know, we're used to the classic Blue Note photos that Frank Wolf took during the Blue Note sessions,
right,
which are fantastic and very dark and moody. And this one is not, you know. I think they're listening to a playback of a take and they're dancing. And I think it gives a sense of the fun nature of the music, you know, that kind of gets lost sometimes amongst the very dramatic, moody black and white shots. You know, this is dance music and treated as such.
Is that Louis Hayes?
That's right, yeah.
Wow. Beautiful.
So this is one of those Frank Wolf photos I was talking about. The reason I wanted to put it might sound weird, but the reason I wanted to put this photo in is because of the high caliber of the knitwear that's on display. You know, these are some fantastic sweaters, and Lee's sweater in particular. It's just because, you know, dress is such an important part of this whole scene. And, you know, it's often commented upon, but at this point in particular, Lee Morgan was a real clothes horse. I mean, we saw that photo from Music City, you know.
Yeah.
The visual representation or the visual presentation of oneself as a musician was a really, really key thing. And there's a lot of very preppy, very quite formal, actually, dress on display here.
Is that an ascot that Art Blakey has on? I think it is.
Yeah, a cravat, yeah. What's the next one? The Cuban heels, another, or Lee boots, as they were named or often known at the time. Yeah.
Is that Van Gelder's studio?
No, that's, I think that's one of the Chicago studios that BJ recorded.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Lee had a contract briefly in the very early 60s to BJ, one of the first Black-owned labels in the country, actually, which kind of interrupted his various Blue Note contracts. And there's a classic. The classic photo. And for lovers of clothing, look at the gauntlet cuffs on the on that suit. Very beautiful. There's also something, you know, there's a kind of a an engagement with an idea of European style here as well. These lots of these Italian suits and I don't know, that sometimes there's a kind of English gentry look being modeled as well. It's a kind of cosmopolitanism, that's what I wanted to say. A real cosmopolitanism.
All right, this is going to have to be the last photo. I think it is anyway, but because I want to bring Duane into the conversation.
Ahead. Sure. This one, and I think this, it were in the last one as well. This is Bobby Timmons. I just wanted to just say something about cool in terms of the way that the visual aesthetic says something about how the musicians are trying to carry themselves in their music as well. And there's lots of photos in the last one, Lee Morgan playing a solo and he's got a cigarette jammed in his trumpet. There's lots of photos like that where people are smoking cigarettes, but there's a good inch of ash hanging off. And it's for me, it really suggests, you know, people who've got time. You know, I'm not smoking a cigarette to try and get down to the nub. I'm taking a drag here and there, but then I'm so still that the ash is there, you know. And I think honestly, you have a look, you'll see a lot of this in jazz photography, especially in this circuit here. And having the cigarette jammed into the trumpet, I was just smoking a cigarette and now I'm just doing this solo. You know, the cigarette will continue to burn. There's really something about a cool aesthetic to say there, you know, which is about I'm taking my time, I'm being in this moment, and I'm just reeling off this fantastic thing as, you know, as the cigarette burns.
All right. Well, thank you, Tom. I think we're going to switch over to Duane now, Suzanne.
Yeah, Duane, I'd love to bring you into the conversation. And
a lot of people are posting questions in the chat, which is great.
Well, wait till the end.
At the end. So you keep putting them in there, but we're not going to maybe get to them necessarily right away. So,
Duane, I wanted you, when you were telling us about how you first found out and listened to Lee Morgan, can you tell us that story? It was a great one.
Yeah, sure. I was in high school. I don't even think I was playing it. I took a break from playing music I was a teenager, so let's leave it at that. So my twin brother Shane, who's a trombone player, went to creative and performing arts with Christian McBride, was there at the same time, Joey DeFrancesco, and a lot of talent was there. And a very good friend of ours, Fred Goodson, who's still a good friend of ours, 30 years later, 40 years later. But anyway, they went to, you know, like I said, they went to school with Chris. And so Chris just gave them a recording. So he says, you know, Fred is a trumpet player. So he said, well, man, check this dude out. You know, that's basically what it was. And he gave them a cassette, and Fred came over. He and Shane used to practice together a lot. So Fred came to the house and said, man, Chris gave me this cassette. You gotta check it out. This dude is bad. And I didn't know who it was. He said, so this guy named Lee Morgan. So we listened to it and it's like, wow. Right away, I knew that was the guy for me.
How old were you then, Duane?
Then I think I was about 16.
And how long had you been playing?
15.
Had you
15. I'd have been playing maybe 4 years, three or four years. Yeah. Sure. So, and I wasn't, you know, thoroughly into, I mean, I was into the music, but I wasn't, I had no idea I'd be performing, you know, professionally. And that would be my life. You know, Fred came over and he and Shane was practicing together. Said, Duane, man, you got to check this trumpet player out. And it was Lee Morgan. And I said, okay, cool, put it on. So we, you know, we checked it out. Like, hey, this dude is bad. And he's like, yeah, he's from Philly. It's like, right away, he's like, what? Oh my God, a homie, you know, playing like that. And ever, I mean, instantaneously, is that a word?
Yeah.
Okay, I've heard it before. Good.
You used it correctly.
instantly, I could use that one too. Instantly hearing it, I knew right away, you know, that I was drawn to him right away. I knew that's what I wanted to sound like, and I felt the connection right away.
So Lee Morgan really influenced your career, like at an early stage. I mean, really kind of rekindled your interest in.
Oh, most definitely. Most definitely.
And at that point, you weren't aware so much of the great jazz tradition of Phil.
Well, I was aware of musicians. I didn't really put, you know, Philadelphia in the mix. My older brother Robin used to teach us about, you know, J.G. Johnson, Miles Davis, Art Blakey. So I knew the names, but Lee Morgan didn't come up at that moment. But and I, you know, I, like I said, I had no idea who he was until I heard the recording, I heard the cassette of all these different recordings. There's some of his recordings, and then there's Art Blakey recordings, I heard Moaning. That's wow, you know, and it just blew my mind. And I've been, you know, hooked on his music ever since.
Wade, why don't you, can you play us a clip of something that you like?
I chose was actually on this cassette. Just one of those things. And
just one of those, yeah.
I think the clip is just his solo. And at the time, he was like 19 years old.
Oh.
Yeah, he was a kid. You know, he was getting a lot of experience playing and hanging out with all the older musicians. And
well, he recorded as a leader at age 18, right, Tom?
This might be the recording.
Yeah.
Lex, can you play it or? Oh, okay.
That's nuts.
Yeah, he's 19 years old there, right?
19, yeah. That, for people that are listening or interested, that's called Heavy Dipper. And that was the one that Blue Note recording, the cooker. And to be 19, only 19, and sound like that is, nobody sounds like that at 19. Nobody.
Yeah. But I have a question I can put it, I can insert in here what you're talking about. This is from Kathleen Hurley. She's asking, both Dizzy and Lee have that piercing, clean, crisp sound. How and or at what point would you say their individual sounds diverge?
Well, that's a great question. Well, Lee played in Dizzy's band, well, his big band, and was a featured artist in his big band when he was like 17 or 18. So that connection is definite. And I think what differs between the two is age. And, you know, Dizzy came up with Charlie Parker, and it's just a different era. But technically, Dizzy, I think, definitely had more technique. So his approach to the instrument was slightly different. Lee Morgan had more of a warm fuzziness to his approach. I think that he got from Clifford Brown, but he had a warm fuzziness to a sound in his approach to music, whereas Dizzy was just like, I'm gonna kick your butt kind of thing. And, you know, that's what he did. But yeah. But it's very interesting that, you know, to be 18 and you find yourself in a Dizzy Gillespie's big band, he's like everybody's hero.
Right.
And so, you know, it makes sense that, you know, he grew the way that he did, as fast as he did, and was able to express himself musically on such a high level.
Yeah. So that you brought up, like, the we're on the verge of talking about the great trumpet tradition of Philadelphia. Of course, Dizzy Gillespie began his professional career here when he was 18, right, 1935. And then between the two of them, he and Lee Morgan, is the great Clifford Brown, who was such a mentor to Lee Morgan when Lee Morgan was young. So you want to talk a little bit about that connection?
Exactly. Yeah, Lee Morgan like all the younger guys, what I think was very important at that time was the sense of community that was in place amongst the musicians, where guys weren't, you know, they took on the responsibility to share their knowledge and their wealth of the art form.
Yeah.
And the willingness of the younger musicians to seek the knowledge. And, you know, I don't see it as prevalent today, but I think that's where their connection, it becomes very evident.
Right. And the other thing I probably should have said at the beginning was, Clifford Brown was born and raised in Wilmington, but in the mid-50s, he moved to Philadelphia. So he was part of that mid-50s jazz scene. I think he was living in West Philly, and Lee Morgan would take the bus or the trolley or something to Clifford's house from North Philly. So again, it was part of that Philly jazz community. Yeah. You know.
Now, did you want, Duane, did you want to play the clip? I noticed you played the clip, picked out I Remember Clifford.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the story behind, you want to tell the story behind that?
Well, this was a composition that Benny Golson wrote.
Another
Philadelphia homie. And, you know, it was that he wrote after Clifford's untimely passing. And, you know, that crippled the jazz musicians, that the scene is just, because from what I understand, Clifford Brown was a very warm individual and, you know, just spreading love and his talent. And the musicians loved him as a person and as a trumpet player, obviously. So so after his passing, Benny Golson wrote this song, I Remember Clifford. And I think they're on this together, if I remember correctly. They're on this recording together. And you can really hear, you know, the emotion.
Yeah.
Brown and missing his teacher, his idol. And you can also hear the influence of Clifford's trumpet playing and ballads. Ballads are really exposing tools for musicians. Yeah. You don't have the luxury of playing fast to skip over anything. Ballads, you're right there and you're exposed. Everything is long, and you can tell in these long tones that you're about to hear that he spent a considerable amount of time with Clifford Brown. You can hear the nuances that remind me of Clifford, the vibrato, the even vibrato that he places on the whole notes. If you play it, you'll hear exactly what I'm talking about.
Okay.
This is Clifford Brown, but it's Lee Morgan.
But let me just quickly say, for those, most of the people on this call probably know this, but Clifford Brown died at the age of 25 in a car accident on the Pennsylvania Turnpike, leaving Philadelphia for a gig in Chicago. And so he was 25, a rising star. Of course, Lee Morgan idolized him. So his death was a crushing blow, not just to Lee Morgan, but to the whole Philadelphia jazz community. He died so young and with so much promise. So his death was so devastating. Yeah. Okay.
And Richie Powell died with him too.
Yeah, Richie Powell. Sorry. And Powell's wife.
That was just the melody. The solo gets even deeper.
Yeah.
Just for time, but you could hear the raw emotion and him just presenting the melody to that composition. And you could hear his pain. You could hear Benny Golson's pain in the writing of it. Mm-hmm. Benny was devastated as well.
Yes.
And everybody was. It was such a tragic situation.
Yeah. So we have time for one more clip, and this is towards the end of, you know, of course, as you might want to describe, Lee Morgan also had a tragic ending young. But towards the end, he was moving in a new direction. And your next clip kind of is an example of that, if you want to sort of introduce that.
Sure. Well, that was one of the things that I admired about Lee Morgan, that he wasn't, I mean, he looked up to Miles as well. So he was able to grasp and reach a pop audience, you know, which is in today it's kind of difficult to do. But he was able, open enough as a musician to embrace a larger audience than just, you know, the hard bop crowd. You know, so but that's one of the things that I admired about him, is that he wasn't he was ambitious enough to pursue other styles of music, and he never stopped growing, never stopped moving forward. So an interesting thing is that Lee Morgan's, my two favorite recordings are his first recording as leader, which we just heard, The Cooker, and his last record, his last recording, The Last Sessions, I think that's what it's called. I think they're both on Blue Note, but I don't have an artist that I can say, maybe, I don't think anyone that has many artists that they can say, I like his very first recording and his very last. Those are my two favorites, you know? And so that me being able to say that was interesting to me as well. But this is The Last Sessions. And you can hear how he's opened things up. The rhythmically, it's a lot more funky. And the instrumentation, there's more instrumentation, there's a lot more interplay. It's a lot freer open vibe, allowing the musicians to explore themselves musically. Thank you.
Wow.
Yeah, very cool.
And I got to butt in because Bertrand Uberall says that was that tune Angela's by Jimmy Merritt.
Yeah, right.
Philly bassist.
Yep.
Yeah.
They played with Lee Morgan for years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He wrote that for Angela Davis, which brings up another aspect of why so attracted to Lee Morgan is courage to speak up for jazz musicians and you know using his stature in amongst musicians to organize guys and to think about what's going on. You know, what was that they get started the J. Was it
Jazz and People's Movement.
That's right.
Yeah, and they ran up in a talk show, the Merv Griffin show. Interrupted the taping, you know, to make a point that, you know, jazz musicians should be seen on the air as well. We should be heard, they should be recognized, and, you know, just as anybody of the pop artists that were being heard at the time. Which is incredible because we're dealing with the same issues today. But, you know, they had the courage to actually say something and voice their opinion and have a movement about it. And, you know, a lot of people got involved. Billy Harper was involved, Rasan, Roland Kirk, and a lot of other musicians who shared the same ideology. So that's another aspect of Lee Morgan. Now we're talking about the individual, the man.
Right.
More so than his music. So I can't say enough about him as an individual. You can hear it in his trumpet playing, you know, and you can hear how he has grown from that 19-year-old robust kid to a grown man. Now he's playing, now my music has me, I have a purpose behind what I'm saying. And you can hear that in this recording. That's why it's one of my favorites.
Absolutely.
A year or two after Bitches Brew, right? Tom or Duane, do you feel that was a major influence on
Lee Morgan? So. I most definitely think so. The use of the Fender Rhodes and the group interplay amongst the musicians. And, you know, it kind of... answers what his statement was about, you know, reaching a wider audience. Miles was, you know, the biggest draw there was in music. And he did so by expressing his music, arranging his music in a certain light, a certain way that gravitated towards people. And I think Lee Morgan took a page out of his book. You know, and he reached that commercial success with the Sidewinder. And I think he was looked at Miles as an idol in that respect.
There's a lot of really, really experimental music on that record. And in his last interview, he says, so I've got this record coming out. It sounds like a Pharoah Sanders record. it's really not what people expect from me. I'm interested to see what people say. And unfortunately, he was gone by the time it did come out. But yeah, it's a real departure, which makes it all the sadder, really.
Yes. We do have some questions here. Let me pick a couple out here. Bertrand Uberall says that the Cooker record came out 2 weeks after Blue Train. And that he also says the song Heavy Dipper was intended for Blue Train, but Coltrane thought it was too skippy.
Skippy.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a different terminology.
Because we haven't played Heavy Dipper yet during this thing. And I was just wondering
if that was the first the first one we played.
Yeah.
Oh, it was. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that was just one of these things.
I think maybe he meant the way the tune was written, there's rest in it. That it's a different feel, I guess, than what Train was getting to at that time. Skippy.
Okay. Can either one of you talk? I'm going to ask Tom this. Tom, do you know why Mass Bomb High School was so important?
Was so important?
Where Lee Morgan went to school.
Well, we as we discussed it earlier, I mean, there were just so many musicians who passed through it. I mean, it was one of the few places where you could go to get that kind of technical education at the time. Obviously, it wasn't just music. It was all kinds of vocational studies were on offer. So much talent came to be grouped together, I'm not sure. I mean, the musicians I talked to who studied there, were very clear that it wasn't a jazz education you were getting there. You know, it was you're playing in ensembles, playing in orchestras and various kinds of things, and you were learning harmony and things like that. But it was nothing to do with what they were playing on their own time. So I'm not sure it was necessarily the nature of the instruction that was delivered there as much as the fact that it just provided a temporary home for all this talent that was already, washing around the city.
Yeah, that's the community thing I was discussing. Mm. These guys gravitated, they protected each other, they stood by each other, and they learned and they grew together. Beautiful.
Plus, the school system back then really took music seriously. And they had some really outstanding music and band teachers. I know a lot of people like Larry McKenna, Billy Root went there, and different people who came out of those schools, unlike today, where music and art are just kind of blown off. So
I think it's important that it's not just for the musicians, but if you've got a lot of music in your schools, then you create the kind of audiences that like listening to jazz as well. I remember talking to Leon Mitchell about this. He said, when all those people down Music City, they had a high level of musical education, which meant they could appreciate what they were listening to. And a lot of these jazz audiences were made up by would-be jazz musicians.
Exactly. All right, we have another question here. Could you talk, maybe you can talk about this, Tom, about the relationship Lee had with his brother, Jimmy?
Yeah, they had a very, very, very close relationship for some time. I mean, Jimmy was a sportsman, I think a baseball player more than anything, but a sportsman, who older than Lee, who was the youngest. There were four brothers, Lee was the youngest. Jimmy was the kind of hero figure for some time, being a great sportsman, until Lee Morgan started to develop his own identity and personality through music, at which point I think the tables turned somewhat. Jimmy was a fixture on the New York scene, following Lee Morgan around, certainly during the Art Blakey years and later on. So yeah, they were very close.
I talked to Jimmy. Well, I met him, and he exactly what you said, Tom. He loved his brother. They had a really tight, close relationship, and maybe they're in relationship with sports and music. Their approach to becoming better at their art, at their craft, may have brought them closer together.
Yeah, I think so. I think all of the Morgans were renowned as being extremely dedicated and brilliant kids. Yeah? And we should say, actually, whilst we're talking about the brothers and sisters, Ernestine Morgan, the Morgan's eldest sister, did an awful lot to develop him as a musician, including helping buy his first trumpet. And then looking after him because, with both parents working all the time, numerous brothers and sisters, Ernestine was really important in bringing Lee Morgan up. She was quite a lot older than he was. So the tightness of the family situation was a really important part in nurturing that talent, definitely.
Yeah, I was talking to Stan Wilson, Don Wilson's brother, about Lee Morgan. I mean, they knew that I loved Lee Morgan a lot. And he said it was one summer, you know, all the kids were outside, coming outside and playing every night, every day. And they said, "Where's Lee?" So they go to his house. "Miss Morgan, can Lee come out and play?" I said, "Oh, no, he's practicing." And they said he did it the entire summer. They went through that. every other day, they'd go and ask his mom, "Can he come out? Can he come out and play with us?" "No, he's practicing." And he stayed in the practice. And like after that summer is like when he really was able to actually play, and he blew everybody's mind. Wow, that's okay. That makes, you know.
Tom, do you think that's the summer that Sonny Stitt embarrassed him at Music City?
I was thinking that just then. Yeah, there's a.
Yeah, why don't you tell that story?
Probably. I heard that. Lee Morgan was not the only person to receive this from Sonny Stitt, but I think it was at Music City, actually, where Sonny Stitt's playing. And everyone says, "Oh, you should get Lee Morgan on stage." And so Lee comes on stage and Sonny Stitt says, "So what do you want to play?" And Lee Morgan's like 14 or 15. So he says, "Oh, anything you want to play." And Sonny Stitt says, "Okay, it's going to be Cherokee in B." And then counts it off at like 4,000 beats per minute. You know, I mean, a horrible tune to play in the worst key imaginable. And it was, you know, it was just one of these many things that exist in jazz lore. Many occasions where someone was taken down a notch in public, and the idea was, well, you're not really at the level that you think you are. The idea being to spur them on to that level. And so, yeah, reputedly, Lee Morgan just went and sat at home for 6 months after that playing Cherokee in B.
I read that that Lee Morgan took Cannonball Adderley to school at Music City because Nelson wrote about it, how Cannonball was really kind of taken down a notch by a young kid on the trumpet. So I hate to close this off because this feels like it's just getting started. You know, he's such a meaty subject. I'm going to ask one more question from the group here, and I want to thank everybody for coming. I think it's wonderful. A couple people here are asking about the movie I Call Him Morgan. And some people think it's terrific and some people don't. So to close this off, what's your opinion, Duane, about, have you seen the film I Call Him Morgan?
Yes, I have. It's kind of hard for me to watch because of the nature of the film, but I love the footage they got of him, and I, you know, me being able to actually see Lee Morgan and his element playing trumpet, the footage for me was wonderful. That was worth it for me. But the subject was, I mean, it is what it is, you know, that's what it was.
That was the point of view, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, I don't know, it's hard for me to say it was a great movie or any, just from the subject matter, you know, it's just, you know, my hero murdered and it's jazz stuff. It's like, wow, what? How am I supposed to feel about that? You know, right. but that's what happened. So yeah. Then at the same time, I can't, you know, knock it for being truthful, you know.
Right.
But the footage was amazing.
Oh, yeah. And we had a lot of people from Philadelphia commenting on it, too, which was really nice. Tom, did you see the film?
Yeah, I've seen it several times. I reviewed it. And so I met the guy. I mean, it's a, you know, it's a very well made film. I have my opinions about it. I don't know. It's as Duane said, I found it very sad. I also found it, to be honest, a little bit one-dimensional because the idea was to tell the story of the relationship with Helen Moore. And it's also based on an interview tape, valedictory interview tape that Helen Moore gave just before she died, which I think is very much Helen's version of events. And basing it around the interview, around the relationship rather, means that it is a rather one-dimensional story, unfortunately. But you know, it's a film about Lee Morgan that is on Netflix, so who can complain, you know? and it's going to get a lot more people into the music, and it's beautifully made as well. And yeah, the footage, the photos, and everything are great.
All right. Well, look, I want to thank
Suzanne. Let me just jump in. Somebody has to mention the new box set that's coming out.
Oh, that's right. Okay, go ahead.
Somebody want to take that, Duane or Tom or?
Yeah, I was listening to it today. It's more of the same because it's the you know, the Lighthouse has had several different reiterations by this point, and it's every set from all three nights. So it's a lot of music, but it's a working band going through their routine. And actually, you can hear, and the stuff that I've heard so far, you can hear them getting better at playing the tunes, basically, you know, which is quite an interesting sort of insight into the process, you know. And
yeah, that's one of my favorite recordings, live at the Lighthouse. I did perform with John Hicks, and he was telling me a story where they had to drive, Lee did like 100 from New York all the way to Baltimore to get to the club on time. And I can imagine the stories that they had going up there, but yeah, but that was like, that's one of my favorite recordings as well. You hear a really clean playing Lee Morgan, and to hear, like Tom was saying, to hear the band develop its material, it's got to be exciting.
Yeah, well, it's pricey. It's a couple hundred dollars for the box set,
but it's worth it. Yeah. All right, well, I want to thank everybody. I want to put up some these are important links here that I want you to go to. Duane Eubanks has a wonderful website, and you can buy his CDs there, his albums, and of course, they're wonderful. The second one is where you can get Tom Perchard's book on Lee Morgan. And that's with Equinox Publishers. And just below that is Tom Perchard's website. And I guess I didn't go through your website, and I'm assuming, did you talk about your new book, Tom, at all with that? On your website?
Yeah, a little bit, as much as I know about it, yeah.
All right. Okay, so you can find out what Tom's up to as far as popular music and jazz is concerned. And last but not least, PhillyJazzHistory.org is our website. And again, it's dedicated to growing community, growing our archival home here in Philadelphia. And again, I'd like to thank Tom Perchard from the University of London. I'd like to thank Duane Eubanks, and he's a great friend and a great artist. Jack McCarthy and Lex Simakis, who is our tech person. And show the last template there. Okay, here's the big ask at the end. Your tax-deductible donation will help the community build the Philadelphia Jazz Archive for everyone to enjoy. So you can drop a few bucks in there to help us out. We would greatly appreciate it. And definitely sign up for our newsletter. We're doing Randy Brecker in September. So you can find out about the Brecker brothers and how they took Philly by storm when they were young kids. Thanks once again. I want to say goodbye to everybody, Duane, Tom, Jack.
Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you.
Yes, thanks very much. Thanks
great
for having
seeing
us.
You. And everybody who came, thank you so much. And you'll be able to get this on our YouTube channel after we do a couple of edits. edits and everything like that. So take care, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thanks so much, everybody. Bye-bye.